Please welcome our panel members, Evan Lyall, Chief Executive Officer, Roush Enterprises, Dennis Mannion, President and CEO, Detroit Pistons and Palace Sports and Entertainment, Brian Walker, President and CEO, Herman Miller, and our moderator, Nancy Kaffer, columnist, Detroit Free Press.
So thank you all for joining us this morning. Here with me on the stage are three gentlemen who have very different stories about how they've had to reinvent their businesses so that they can stay relevant in a marketplace which we all know is always changing regardless of what industry that you're in. Our guests have been able to adapt, reinvent, and change things so that they can continue to successfully grow. And we're going to talk a little bit about how they've done that and also about how the importance of being able to quickly adapt to the changes in the marketplace has played into the strategic moves that they've made. So Evan, there's no question that Roush is an iconic name in the world of racing, but I think people would be surprised to know the other kind of stuff that you do. Tell us more about the broad array of things that you offer.
All right, thank you, Nancy. We are known for our motorsports activity. It's definitely a calling card that opens a lot of doors for us, but unbeknownst to many that aren't in the automotive industry in particular, we have a pretty significant enterprise right here in Michigan that's involved in automotive engineering, and really it's expanded into product development in many different verticals. We call it Roush Industries, and there's about 3,000 people in the state of Michigan right now that are working in that business. We have two products companies. One's Roush Performance Products, and the other's Roush Cleantech. And those are entities that we've started to take advantage of having a product opportunity, use our brand recognition we have for motorsports, but also get involved direct to the consumer and use our engineering activities. So Roush Performance Products is involved in the automotive aftermarket, high performance stuff, really cool cars. Check out the website, it's kind of a lot of fun for automotive enthusiasts. And then Roush Cleantech is the same concept, taking our engineering capability and looking for an alternative or opportunity to work in alternative fuels. And there we have a propane fuel system that we sell, coupled with a Ford powertrain to fleet operators. An example, Bluebird School Buses is our largest customer in that arena, and they put 3,000 propane fuel systems in from Roush last year. It's greener, so they get a social element there, and it's cheaper. And so the fleet operator gets two benefits that work very well. And we have a small manufacturing activity, and we do some tooling and a bunch of other things that are related to automotive in the state of Michigan.
Dennis, tell us about Palace Sports and Entertainment. What percentage of the business is the sports part versus entertainment?
Well, it's pretty much half and half. We have three facilities, the Palace in Meadowbrook and DT Music Theater, as you know, and we probably do somewhere around 75 concert events a year and of course, the 41 basketball games and hopefully playoffs at some point. So it's got about 1,200 employees in total, full-time and part-time, and it's... not big like Evan's company, but it's got some social firepower.
Okay. Brian, talk to us a little bit about what Herman Miller does and how you've stayed a leader in your industry.
Yeah, well, we would say our mission is creating inspiring designs for the places where people live, work, learn, and heal. Ultimately, though, our job is to help you do what you do better, whether that is creating a great environment for your family, whether that is helping people heal faster, helping universities teach better, or companies to innovate more and grow their businesses.
So the workplace has changed, and the way people live has changed a lot over the course of the company. How do you ensure that what you're making fits into what people need now as the way that people use your products change?
Well, first of all, I think at the heart of Herman Miller has always been the idea of problem-solving design. So while we do, I think, beautiful products like these that we're all sitting in, we always start with the idea of how we're solving a problem. And I think sort of the core sort of key success factor for us around that is we've always believed that we're at the center of a network rather than we have to do it all. So a lot of our design starts with a network of designers from around the globe, from as far away as Turkey to India. We're always looking for ideas everywhere in the globe. That to me means we have to be both disciplined in how we think about problems that people have that use our products, whether it's in their home or in their business. But we also have to be very open to what I always call serendipitous exchange. How do we find an idea that we weren't looking at or looking for, but we're willing to follow people? And I think that's often why great designers bring us their ideas, because we'll often invest more than anyone else in an idea that may seem crazy to other people, where we think there's a spark of innovation or an idea that's going to solve a problem in a unique way.
Okay. So Dennis, your business is a little bit different from these other ones in that you have a team that people have very strong feelings about, one way or the other, depending on how they're doing involved in what you do. How do you stay competitive and keep things growing even when, say, the Pistons are having an off season?
Well, it's sort of the social impact of the sports teams and sports leagues is at the ceiling of the room here, and the economic impact is really at the floor. And in between, there's all kinds of entrepreneurial opportunities, creative and economic. So a big part of what we've done is, you know, and many companies are doing, we've sliced and diced and customized our fan base up. Going back 30 years ago, it was a cradle-to-grave business. We now kind of customize not just into men, women, and kids, but by business segment, too, and use that database to drive different products and services that people would care about in addition to the basketball team. Of course, winning is number one, but we still want to be able to provide other things for people to do.
So how has technology and social media weighed into that? Do things help you? I mean, there's all these different ways to interact with that experience.
It's the great accelerator, and it's going to be very interesting to see where television and typical distribution mediums go. We're all now in a position to customize our content. And it was always, you know, content is king, but now customization is queen. So for us, social media and all the different digital distribution channels that are arriving on the scene are manna, because we can directly go to kids of one age group and adults of another age group and go to B2B the same way.
Okay. So Evan, you have spent literally your entire career at Roush. You started with a summer job there. So that's some pretty significant longevity. How has your industry changed, and how? What have been the challenges in adapting through that progression?
Yeah, hopefully it's not just because I could never find another job. I'm not sure. I like to think that's not the case, but I was really fortunate quickly. I was 34 years ago, I met Jack, and unfortunately I wasn't 10 years old. And I had the opportunity to come to work for a guy that was just driven. It was 26 employees in one little building. And today it's turned into the company that it is. And it's changed dramatically in that time frame. Of course, we've expanded in this full-service product development company. But quite honestly, more importantly to me, I think, to really why we're here 40 years later, is what hasn't changed. That's what's been really key. And the guy started it with a work ethic that, you know, beats the band. I mean, it's unbelievable how hard he works. Still does today at 74 years old. And that carries over for sure. But it's really from a technical curiosity. And so everything we do is from an engineering perspective first, and then we've branched out and added the other skill sets. And that's just served us very well, along with the third thing that's really important, that's continually reinvesting in the business. And so as there's been opportunity, we haven't been afraid to put the capital towards it to find, you know, the next job, whatever it might be. And that's becoming very important today, because we're in industry that is changing quickly. And so making sure that you have the right skill sets, a lot of that's been talked about here tonight, really important in our space.
But in a lot of that, you can do all the homework and prepare all that you want, but there's going to be times when you kind of have to make a leap based on your best guess or on faith or belief that a trend is going to go a certain way. How do you sort of sort out when something, when numbers and background work can't tell you anymore and you've got to make a leap? How do you do that?
You know, we've been embedded in the automotive space so tightly that I think we have a really good insight into where it's going, and so we're able to be involved almost with the OEMs to sort of predict where the next need is and hopefully make investment. But interestingly, some of the verticals we've expanded into was talked about today, all the things that are going on in Orlando. The entertainment industry is the biggest expansion for our business in the last 2 years. Disney has become our fourth largest customer. They're coming here to get engineering resources from a company that's been traditionally automotive, but it's really product development. It's the same kind of skill sets that are required. And as we got into that business, we've had to try and learn what their cues are and understand where the right place are to make investments. I think you've got to be embedded. You've got to be paying attention to your customers. And in our case, being predominantly a service business, we've gotten very good over time at being very reactive. And that's you have to do.
Okay. Brian, what is one way that you, as a CEO, stay in touch with your organization and what's going on in there in a way that might surprise people?
I don't know if it surprised people. I would say I always check myself on my calendar to figure out how much time I'm actually in front of customers working deals. Because in our business, ultimately, it's almost like a quasi-construction business. So You know, I'm always checking with my assistants, how many days were I out in the field actually working with salespeople on customers? First of all, I think not only is that important because it drives revenue, but more importantly, I think that's where my best learning comes from, of where are we actually striking a chord with people? And often by, you know, we are fortunate to serve the best companies in the world. The ability to be with those folks, whether it's their CEOs or their folks that are running HR, and really hearing what are the things they're worried about, I think is the best way for me to bring back to the team sort of scans. Because I think our innovation agenda sort of works on a multiple layers of how are we scanning society? Because we believe that most of the great design is a response to social change. So we have to be good scanners of what's going on in society. So to me, the best way for me to scan is to be out with customers on a regular basis.
Okay. Dennis, what's the biggest challenge on the horizon for your business?
Well, I think for all of our businesses, and it's funny to listen to people speak from an entrepreneurial standpoint. Mm-hmm. Entrepreneurialism in and of itself becomes very individualistic. And the call of the day is really one of getting context and building consensus and then getting yourself to a place where you can communicate at a higher level. And to me, collaboration is the key to our future, the way in which we create communication with a little bit of friction to create better products and services. And to me, it was really easy, interesting about what was the best thing you could do for, to stimulate entrepreneurialism and within the state. And it's putting these entrepreneurs together, because some swim in an administrative swim lane and create products and services for that, and some in a marketing swim lane and some in a sales swim lane. Putting those swim lanes together, to me, would be a fast way to grow the pot.
So, all of you have to respond to the way that people communicate about your products and services has changed. The reach of the average person is now tremendously expanded through social media. How does your organizations keep tabs on that, or how do you feel that it's benefited or made it more challenging? Would you like to go with that? Anyone? Anyone can jump in on that.
I'll start because I probably got the smallest piece, but our services business is so focused on one industry mm-hmm. that it's not as important okay. to us. But as we got into the performance products area, I just came back from the SEMA show in Las Vegas, which is all the aftermarket people. It is all social media. It's the only way that you grow your business out there. We started a brand, Loudmouth Exhaust System, brought in local Mob Steel guys to our booth, and it was unbelievable the reach that had just by having them in place, and we've been back for a week. And to measure the kind of activity that went on in that business and what it's going to drive is amazing. So we've got young people on board in those businesses that are completely focused on what we do to get our brand out on all the social media channels.
Just sometimes social media feedback isn't always great, and then what do you do when that happens?
I don't know. It's only if you have a 19-year-old player that becomes a real problem.
I think you have to stay in front of it and monitor it, right? I mean, you have to be out there, I think, vigilant about it, and not to control it, but I think you have to be good as you see it moving to know why it's moving. And I think to today's world, the one thing you can't do is you can't be anything but genuine, because if mm-hmm. what you say isn't genuine, you will be smoked out in a hurry, in my opinion. Absolutely. So my mantra for our group is we don't want to create customers, we want to create fans. We don't want to create places, we want to create experiences. We don't want to do transactions, we want to have relationships. And I think if we focus on those three things with all of our audiences, and we really think of our customer base as our different ones, because we really have four or five key verticals, we think of those as audiences, not as customers. And we're often always asking, how are we reaching out to them in the way that they want to be talked to? And how do we create a dialogue with them rather than a one-way broadcast? And to me, once you get into a dialogue, you learn faster. And actually, even when you have bad problems, when you're in a dialogue, it's amazing how fast people recover.
I would say, I'm sure in your business, same as mine, sometimes a bad thing that's happened, depending on how you react to it, it's unbelievable what it can do for your brand in the long haul. We've had several instances of that. And to go above and beyond customer satisfaction in that arena is probably the best thing anyone can do for their business.
Would someone like to describe a specific instance in which something bad happened and you did have that opportunity to? Does anyone want to talk about a failure? Anyone?
Well, in our business, obviously, we have numerous examples of whether people have seating issues or food issues or even issues with the team or the performer. And to Evan's point, that's clearly the case when you communicate with them and quickly and go beyond just being relevant, really develop a relationship, the revenue seems to fall in a positive direction. So we're big on getting to the complaints as fast as we can. And to your point, Brian, like, that's where all the innovation is. 9 out of 10 times they're giving you the answer to the problem you've created.
I have a friend who often says that a problem is an opportunity dressed in drag. My example, I guess, for you is, I remember the year that the iPhone came out, I was waiting in line in front of a Verizon store. What were they on? Only AT&T. Buying my wife an iPhone, because at the time Herman Miller didn't support anything with Apple, which has changed dramatically. And I was standing there, my BlackBerry buzzed, and it was a guy who had found me online on our website, who had went somewhere and bought one of our chairs, an Aaron chair. He thought he used one at work. He loved it. He went and ordered one, and he ordered a C size, which is a big chair, and found out that when he got it, he didn't like the way it fit. And went to work, talked to his facilities people, and found out he had a B size at work. So he went back to where he bought it and said, I'd like to return it. And the person said, well, there's a stocking fee, and blah, blah, blah. I went through all this stuff, and he wrote me this note and said, hey, I bought your chair, I love your company, but I've had this really bad experience. And I was literally standing in the parking lot of the AT&T store, and I called him there in this parking lot and said, hey, it's 4th of July weekend, nobody's in the office today, but I want to let you know that I'm all over this, and I will take care of it for you on Monday. And he goes, am I being punked? Yeah. And I said, no, it's me, really. And he goes, seriously, you called me back on the 4th of July? And I said, I got your message, and I have a rule that if you send me a note, you hear directly from me. That's the way it works. And we got him a chair, and he sent me a note a couple weeks later. It turned out he was in a consulting business, and he did speeches on great customer service. And he said, you made the list.
Oh, that was awesome.
That was the opportunity, in disguise, or drag, or whatever you want to call it. So you guys have all talked about a lot about the importance of staying connected to what customers want and the innovation that goes along with that. How much of your time or your resources are rightly spent looking at that as opposed to maintaining the core business function? Like, how does that roughly, I mean, or are they so connected that it's, I mean, give me a little breakdown on that.
In our business, they're fairly connected, similar to Brian. I try and get in front of customers as much as possible, so you're getting direct feedback all the time. And one thing that I have, and all the people that work around me know, it's always bad news first. You know, I think a lot of times companies, especially as they get larger, I've seen this with our business gets larger, we always want to make the presentation and celebrate all our successes, and that's good. We need to do that. I'm not a Scrooge. I think that we do need to talk about the positive things that are going on, but if you do that and don't bring to me the bad news, because we need to get that on the table to be able to talk about it. And generally the bad news is from customer feedback. And that bad news might be too strong, but it's the things that we need to work on to improve, to get customer satisfaction to the levels they need to be. And it's different for me in the two businesses. The services side is definitely daily. In the products business, you know, you have all the traditional customer service kind of interactions. And we start every one of our review meetings with a look at those customer reaction decks. And that generally tells you, you know, how you're doing, and you decide, is that where we need to put our resources?
Yeah, I think we've all had an explosion in data and analytics, especially around our customers. And for me, it's been consolidating the data so you get it into meaningful and usable, snackable bites of information. And obviously, our feedback is constant because it's so transactional in many ways. But for us, we profile, package, push, and there's always the perfect piece. So after we've executed, let's get to that fourth P.
Mm-hmm. You know, in our business, I like to take about half of my time, between 25% with customers, and I try to spend at least another 25 to 30% only on innovation. So one of the things I do very deliberately is the head of R&D and the head of design report to me directly. And I spend a lot of time with those two guys traveling around the world just going to visit our creative partners. And sometimes it's not with an agenda. We don't know what they're working on. We show up in New York City and we'll have appointments with 5 or 6 different creative partners. And we'll spend a week just listening. What are they working on? But we want to know, what are they not working on for Herman Miller? Things that they might be working on in the tech industry. So for me, it's the funnest part of the job, to be frank. And I think if you run a business that's based on innovation, you have to love the things that you create. That means sometimes, by the way, you overlove them and you overinvest in them because they seem like great ideas, but you can't figure out how to get them to market. So I think, you know, my challenge often is we love ideas. I think one of the earlier panelists said, hey, the hard thing is to decide when to quit. I always think that's the hardest job at one level is you love your children and your designs become your children over time if you know the stories. And for me, I don't want to know just what it is. I want to know the why. I want to sit with the designer or the creator and I want to hear what's in their head. Why did they come up with it? What are they trying to think about? And to me, if you do that early in the process, you get a lot more vested in how to actually get it to market.
So I think we have just a couple minutes left here. Really quickly, if each of you could tell me what's next for each of your companies.
In our business, we have a goal to double the size of the business from where it is today. And our plan is to do that by continuing to expand the products business to be as large as the service activity. And so it's causing us to have to really invest in infrastructure that we didn't have with our services business. And we're spending a lot of time on our IT infrastructure and materials management's become a very big deal for us. I have some banker friends in the audience, and trust me, I'm working on it, guys. And so we're really focused on trying to get our products business to continue to grow at a fast rate that it has been.
I think for us in sports, the experiential side outside of just the games or the concerts are going to become very, very big. So back when I was at the Dodgers, we started to do yoga out on the field with players. And that's expanded into everything from wine tastings to micro beer nights and into Palace Fit programs and 5Ks. There's this need, I think, because of all the technological acceleration of communication to get physical again. And people are looking for places to bond, but they want to bond with people that are like them, you know, within their customized cluster. So for us, that's the next step.
Well, Herman Miller, I think our overarching goal right now is to become much more of a lifestyle business. And, you know, if you know anything about our history, we really started with these kind of products and classic designs. We then became really driven by sort of the B2B market and serving offices. And today, the fastest growing part of the business is actually on the consumer side. And so we see ourselves as being really integrated across all of those different audiences that we talk to with a much broader footprint that is both global and across both contract and consumer. That's really the future we're trying to create.
Okay, well, thank you so much for being here with us this morning. Weren't they great?
Thank you. So,